All right, so good morning, everybody. Welcome to lecture 28 of quantum mechanics part one. In our last class, we were continuing to look at the quantum harmonic oscillator. And we saw that using the commutation relations, one can determine the action of the ladder operators on our states. And we can determine the coefficients here. And we can see that how to create any state starting from the ground state by acting on it with the ladder operator n times. But there is a normalization coefficient that is very important. And then I talked about how to, just please give me 1 second. So I was talking about how to calculate these expectation values and writing the position and momentum operators as superpositions of the ladder operators, it becomes very easy to calculate these expectation values because the ladder operators have a very simple action on these states, right? And we know that these states like n and n plus one are orthogonal to each other. Okay. And then I briefly explain what's going on with Hermite polynomials and all. Okay, am I audible? Sorry, Sonali, do you have a question? Okay. Can somebody tell me if I'm audible or not?
No, sir.
You are audible to me, sir.
Okay.
Audible. All right.
Okay, great. Okay, now I think it might be a network problem on your end, Sonali. I don't know what else to say apart from that because sorry about that. Okay, so now so yesterday also one student mentioned to me that they are having difficulty in following a lot of things in this class because they are not so familiar with this whole like vector space, algebra and thing. Okay, yeah, no issues, Sonali. Just try to follow what you can, otherwise I'll share the recording and you can view it later on, okay? So my thinking was that I should take a pause and just go over the basics for a couple of lectures. So for the next 2-3 lectures, I was thinking that I should just talk about this whole bracket and Hilbert space and vectors and all a little bit in more detail. So I just want to ask everybody, like, are you interested? Would that be helpful for you? Can you please raise your hand if you think that I should do that? Okay, good. All right, then I guess that's a yes. All right, you can lower your hand. Okay, so let's do that today. We'll go back to basics. Okay. Recap of the vector algebra that is necessary for our purposes. All right. So the first thing is that what is this object? This object is just a vector, okay? Now I presume everybody knows what vectors are and what matrices are, right? That much prior knowledge, of course, one has to assume. So when I write something like this, right, I call this ket of psi. I'm referring to a vector, right? Now, what happens in quantum mechanics is that vectors can be either infinite dimensional or finite dimensional. Now, finite dimensional vectors are something that you're all comfortable with. So it is the infinite dimensional part that I think confuses a lot of people. Okay. Well, so first of all, forget about the infinite or finite dimensional aspect. Okay. We'll talk about that later. Just think of this as a vector, right? And it's a vector that lives in an n-dimensional vector space. So we won't like say that n is finite or infinite. It can be anything. And how do I write down a vector, right? I say that I have some set of basis vectors in my Hilbert space. And I can expand this vector by taking the components of the projection of this vector onto these basis vectors, right? And how do I find these components? What do? I take my vector and I project it onto the basis vector, right? So for instance, if you have some vector u, let's say you're in three dimensions. So you would say this is ux, u hat, ux, x hat, uy, y hat, uz, z hat. So how would you find uy? You would take u and you would take the dot product with y hat, right? Now, these are all real vectors, right? Real vectors, which means that, what does that mean? That means all the coefficients are real numbers. Okay. And then I have some things like u dot u, right? What is u dot u? That is the norm of this vector, right? And I get that u dot u right, is this expression. And how do I get this expression? I get this expression by making the observation that all of these basis vectors are orthogonal to each other and they are orthonormal. They are normalized, right? Which means that the length of each one of these unit, that these are all unit vectors, right? Now, when you're talking about complex vectors, okay, so let's say that I have a complex vector now, okay, where my coefficients are now complex numbers. Fine. But now since we are in a we are talking about complex objects, then I can define a conjugation also, right? What will be this conjugation? It will be, right? The conjugation will apply to the components and to the basis vectors. And this is obviously not in general going to be the original vector, right? Now, what will happen if I try to take this norm squared, the length of any vector, right? Once again, let me make the assumption that these basis vectors are orthonormal to each other. So then what will I get for the norm squared? I will get this expression, right? Ui squared sum. But the thing is that since ui is a complex number, ui squared will also be in general a complex number. And the sum of these will also be a complex number. So the norm squared of a vector will also be a complex number, right? In general. Right? Because these coefficients are some complex numbers. So the square of a complex number is another complex number. The sum of those numbers is another complex number. So now, if we want the length of any vector to be a real number. Okay. And why? Well, there are very good reasons for why we want this to be the case, right? Because the length of the vector turns out to be a measure of probability, and probability should be real, right? They are real and non-negative, right? So we want the length of a vector to be real and non-negative. Now, if you give me a complex number, right, then z squared is a complex number also. How do I get a real number out of this, right? I just take the complex conjugate of the number and multiply it by itself, right? That gives me a real number, right? So if you say that you have a vector like this, right? And what you want is you want some quantity, which is the length of this vector squared, let's say, which is greater than or equal to zero. How can you do that? Well, one very simple way to do that is to define this length to be this product, this sum, right? Sum of the product of each coefficient multiplied by its complex conjugate. Now, each one of these numbers will belong to R. They're all real numbers. And so the whole expression will also be a real number. Right? And also it will be greater than or equal to zero, because the amplitude of any complex number is always greater than or equal to zero, right? So this means what? This means that if I want to write down u square, the length square, I cannot write it as u dot u, right? What do I have to write it as? I have to write it as u complex conjugate u, right? Okay, so this is the first thing. Now, let's come to the notation part a little bit. How do I multiply matrices? Right? So let's say I have a matrix that has m rows and p columns, and I want to multiply it with another matrix. So what do I know? I know that that matrix must also have how many columns? It must have p columns, right? Sorry, it must have p rows. And how many columns can it have? It can have any number of columns. Let's say n, right? So when I multiply these two matrices, what do I get? I get an m by n matrix with m rows and n columns, right? Okay, so now, and we will deal with square matrices only, okay? So if I have a matrix, all right, and we normally put this symbol under a letter to say denote that it's a matrix. How do I write this? So A is some n by n matrix, right? So this U, what should it be? Can it be a column vector? No, right? It has to be a row vector. Sorry, it has to be a column vector, meaning that there's only one column, but there are n rows. So when you multiply this, so how should you think of this? How many rows are there? There are n rows. You should think of this as an n by one matrix, right? And what is this? This is an n by n matrix, right? So when you take an m by p matrix and you multiply it by a p by n matrix, what do you get? You get an m by n matrix. So if you take an n by n matrix and multiply it by a n by one matrix, what do you get? You get another n by one matrix. And what is that? That is another column vector, right? So we write this in this way, right? This is another column vector. Now, if I have an n by n one matrix and I take the transpose, what does that give me? That gives me a one by n matrix. So if I have some vector u, I take the transpose of this vector, right? So if u is a n by one matrix, then the transpose of u is a one by n matrix. Right, it's a row vector. So this is U and this is U transpose, right? So when I talk about, when I say that I'm calculating this object, right? I'm saying that I'm doing this. Now I should think of both of these as matrices, right? So if I use this notation, then what am I saying? I'm saying that I have a n by one matrix and I'm multiplying that by n by one matrix. Is that allowed?
No, sir.
That's not allowed. So what I have to do is I have to write u transpose times u, right? So I do away with this dot system. So everything is matrix multiplication, right? Everything is matrix multiplication. Everything is a matrix. Even a single number is also a matrix. It's a one by one matrix, Now this is fine because this gives me a 1 by n times n by 1, which gives me a 1 by 1 matrix, which is a number. Right? So when I write down this object, U square, what am I doing? I'm taking U transpose and multiplying it with U, right? And this is a real number. If U is a real vector, but it's a complex number, if U is a complex vector. So how do I get a how to get a real number from a complex vector? What would you do? You would take U star dot U, right? But as we just explained, this is wrong notation, right? So what we want to do is we want to write it like this instead. We want to write it as U star transpose times U. So this is the correct notation. Right? And what is U star transpose? This is what we refer to as U dagger, right? This is called the Hermitian conjugate. Right? But now you can do this operation for any matrix, right? You can take any matrix. And also, these two operations can be interchanged. They commute with each other. The conjugate of the transpose is equal to the transpose of the conjugate, right? Okay. Is this fine so far? Are there any questions? Now, let's go back to the very beginning. In the very beginning, we use this notation, right? We said that this ket vector is just a vector, right? With an arrow, something with an arrow, right? So let's go back to this. This sign means is equivalent to. So this means equivalence. This is vector, right? All right. So this is my ket. But now I have another object, right? This is my bra vector. And you have to remember that the bra vector is not going to be the same as the ket vector, right? The components are not the same because it's complex conjugated, no? Right? So if U is real, then we can say that the components of U transpose are equal to the components of U, right? But if U is a complex vector, then the components are not equal, right? The components of U complex transpose are not equal to the components of of you, right? Yes? Because you're taking the complex conjugate of all the components. So if I say this brass eye, this is not the same vector, right, in terms of components. Escape size. Yes? And that is the reason why we use a different representation, a different notation, different symbol. We call this a ket and we call this a bra. Because they are not identical to each other. And now we can write down this object. Right? And how should I understand this? This is, it is this expression, right? It's the transpose conjugate multiplied by the vector. And this is always going to be greater than or equal to zero, and it's a real number. So I should say that it belongs to R plus. Right? Is this okay so far? Are you guys able to follow?
Yes, sir.
Now, so now we can do this for any two different vectors also, right? So if I take any two vectors, u and v, then the quote unquote dot product, I define it as u dot v, right? But as I already said, this is not the correct notation. So the correct notation would be to say that you take u transpose and you multiply it by v. There is no dot, right? But what, so that's if these are real numbers. But if these are complex vectors, right, this is the same belongs to sign, I'm just putting it reversed, because then there are two possibilities. When I choose to multiply these two vectors, there are two possibilities. One is and there are two options, right? One is that I can take U Hermitian adjoint, multiply that by V, and the other is I can take V Hermitian adjoint, multiply that by U. How do I write this in terms of the bracket notation? U, V. And what is this? This is bra V and ket U, right? And these two are related to each other. How? One is the complex conjugate of the other. Right? If you take the complex conjugate of this, you will get this expression. Right? So we have to be careful about which one is the bra vector and which one is the ket vector, right? In the case of complex vectors. For real vectors, we don't have to worry about this, obviously, right? Now, let's come to, let's talk about this thing, matrices, okay? Again, let's come back to matrices again. Right, this is our notation, right? For a matrix acting on a vector. Now, let's say that I have some third vector, W, okay? And I want to take W, the dot product of W and V, the scalar product, I should say, not the dot product. What is the correct way to write it? W transpose times V, right? So what is this? This is W transpose times A times V. Right? And again, this is all for real vectors. What about for complex vectors? Well, for complex vectors and complex matrices, this is fine, right? But now if I want to take this scalar product, what should I do? I should take the complex conjugate transpose, right, of one of these vectors. Which vector? Should it be the complex conjugate transpose of V or the one of W? Right, so there are two possibilities. Which possibility do I want? Well, I should look at this expression. Here U is on the right of A, right? So in terms of this bracket notation, how should I write this? I should write it like this. So this is my matrix or my operator. It acts on the ket vector and gives me another ket vector, right? And so when I say W dot V, what I actually mean is W V, this inner product, right? Because here V is on the right hand side. So how should I write it? I should write it as this. Priya, you turned your video off, but actually it's really helpful for me if I can see somebody's face, because there's like, it makes teaching it so much simpler. So I know that there was some, I hope that you don't have any difficulty keeping the video on. I can't expect anybody else to do it. Everybody else is, I don't know, too shy, I guess, or something. So this object can be written in this way, right? This inner product. So when I write down W A V, what am I doing? I'm taking W complex conjugate transpose times A times V, right? And I can do all of this in terms of components also, right? So for instance, if I take AV and I want to write it in terms of components, what do I say? I say AIJ, VJ, or I'll come to the components in a second, okay? First, let us look at this expression again. So how did we get this expression? Sorry, this should be U, not V. right? Now, if you look at this expression, right? How did we get this expression? We started with A times U, and then we took the inner product with W, right? So this thing is called the inner product. Right, rather than the dot product, it's called the inner product. And so to get this expression, what we did was we started with A times U, this gives me a vector V, and then we took the inner product of V with another vector W, right? But now if you look at this expression, there is another way to view this expression rather than seeing it as this object times this object. There's another way to see it, which is that you can view it as this object, right? I can group the vectors and matrices in a different manner, right? So I can, what is this? This is W, A, then times U, like this, right? And what is this A acting on bra W? Well, this will be some other bra vector. And since I've taken U, V, W, O, P, Q, R, S, T, I'll call this T. I can write this as T, U. Right? Where? What is this T? It is this object. Right? Is all of this clear so far? Are there any questions? Is there any doubt? Is this clear?
Yes, sir.
Anybody else?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Is this helping to clarify anything, any of the aspects that we have been talking about in all semester?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now we can write down, when we say we are calculating the expectation value, of some operator A in some state psi A. Well, this is what I'm doing. I'm taking psi, complex conjugate, transpose, multiplying it by A, then multiplying it by psi. Right? Now, remember that if I have an object like this, I can take its complex conjugate, that gives me UT, right? So I can take something like this and take its complex conjugate, right? What is this? Well, let me write it like this. Psi times phi. Complex conjugate, right? Where this is equal to phi, right? And what is this object? This object becomes phi times psi, right? So now if A times psi is equal to phi, ket phi, then what is bra phi, right? right? So now bra phi is the Hermitian conjugate of cat phi, right? And vice versa, right? So this is equal to A times psi, Hermitian conjugate. Okay. Now you take any two matrices and you ask me, tell me what is the transpose of the product? Well, that's equal to the product of the transposes in the opposite sense, right? B, T. This is true regardless of the dimensionality of these matrices, right? A and B could be row matrices, column matrices, or some mixture, right? So if I take A times psi and take the transpose, right, what should I get? I should get psi transpose. So, but now let me not take the transpose. Let me take the, so this applies for the transpose. What about the Hermitian conjugate? It will be the same because it's just complex conjugation. Complex conjugation will carry through. So if I take A times psi and I take the Hermitian conjugate, what will that give me? That will give me the Hermitian conjugate of psi, right? But now to the right of A, and the Hermitian conjugate of A multiplied by the Hermitian conjugate of A, right? What is this? This is equal to bra psi A Hermitian conjugate. Right? So now let me come back to this expression that I had earlier. Okay? So if I come back to this, I have this. What is this expression? This expression is psi A dagger psi. Right? And if A is equal to A dagger, which means that A is a Hermitian matrix, then what do I get? I get that this is equal to, right? So this is equal to the complex conjugate of this expression, right? Because this object is equal to psi phi star. So this implies that this becomes a real number, right? Because it is equal to its own complex conjugate. Why? Because A is equal to A dagger, right? So this is equal to its own complex conjugate, which tells me that this is a real number. Right? So this is why when we ask what is the result of a measurement, when we are taking expectation values of some operator, and we want the results of measurements to be real numbers. So how that is, that means that the operator should be Hermitian. Because if they're Hermitian, then these expectation values will be real. Okay? You guys have a class at 9?
No, sir.
No. What time is your next class?
9:45.
Okay, so can I continue for a little more?
Yes, sir.
Is that fine with everybody else?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I've never seen such enthusiasm. Good. That means that I'm doing something right. Okay. So I hope that up till this point, whatever I've talked about, has clarified the bracket notation for you all. Okay. Now, when I say clarified, it means that you have to sit down with a piece of pen and paper, with a pen and a piece of paper, and work out everything from A to Z on your own. Okay. Just watching me do it is not going to... So to give you an analogy, if you want to build your muscles, you go to the gym, right? And there is an instructor there, and that instructor picks up some weights and does some repetitions, right? And then you watch the instructor do that for 60 minutes, and then you go home, and then you say, oh, I'm so tired. I've done so much work. Then next day you wake up, and then you look in the mirror and you're like, I don't see any change. Right? It is exactly the same thing. I'm only here to show you the right form. You have to do the exercise on your own. Okay. So I'll stop here. I think this is enough for one day. Right. And then in the next class, I will talk more about the finite dimensional and infinite dimensional aspect. Okay. I'll talk about that in detail. So any questions? So I will.
Sir, I have a question regarding the attractive Dirac delta potential. Sir, I do not
get what. I am not talking about attractive Dirac potential. Like, I mean,
you have asked.
I'm like on a completely different theme right now. Okay. I'm talking about the very basic things, huh? Do you have a question about that?
No, sir. The Dirac notation is clear.
So I'm talking about Mahabharata. You want to ask me a question from Ramayana. Stick with the program, right? You can ask me a question separately. I don't have any objection to that. But just now, I want questions about this. Okay. So, again, all of this is very beautifully explained in Barak Shoshani. Barak Shoshani has some lecture notes, which I've shared with you all. He also has videos on YouTube for his course. And look, if you want to be a physicist, if you want to do research in physics, or if you want to take a career that is physics oriented, research oriented, this stuff you have to understand it, okay? Because quantum mechanics is physics. It is there in everything, in every industry today. So if you don't understand this notation, then you will end up in trouble at some point, okay? And of course, this is the way to do quantum mechanics. So as far as the course is concerned, this is what I follow. So any questions? No? Yes? No? Okay. Then I will stop it here, and I will send you some exercises to do. Okay. There will be exercises from Barak Shoshani's lecture notes.
Okay, sir.
All right. So I'll see you all on Monday. Okay.
Okay, sir.
All right. I'll stop the recording then.